like it's supposed to be. It's starting to change and change and change. And I had to get me some water. I might have left my water back there. But, anyway, we're going to go ahead and get started with the word of prayer. We're going to be in John chapter 11, verses. I'm going to be verses 17 to 27. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and get those as well, because we're going to have to go to John chapter 10 and look at some stuff to kind of make the lesson a little bit more plain for those that may not have the best understanding of it. So if you don't mind, if we stand, we'll have us a little prayer to get started. We're a few minutes behind, but that's all right. That just means we're here. Amen. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for bringing us to the house of prayer safely, for peaceful rest, and for all of the blessings you've given to us. As we assemble together this morning, we don't come for any vain reason. Father, we just pray that you can filter through our hearts and help our motivation to be just to learn about you. Now, Father, we know that once we know better, you hold us accountable for that. So help us to trust you, to lean on you, to love you. Pray that you will shape our lives to give your name glory. We ask you this in the name of Jesus. Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
And amen. Following took place. And Jesus walked in the temple, verse 20. are God's only begotten Son. Chapter 10, verse 25, next verse. Jesus gives them an answer. He says, I told you and I showed you. In verse number 25, I told you, you did not believe. The works that I do, the miracles that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. We're going to get to verse number 26 next. But Jesus said, listen, y'all have enough evidence to know if I am who I said I am. And you know how when tension gets heated and sometimes people can ask you a question and they already know the answer to the question. But they're asking you a question because they're mad. They're asking you a question to start a conversation, really to start an argument. You know, Jesus responds accurately, logically. He said, listen, not only have I told you who I am, I have showed you who I am. Then we get to verse number 25 at the B portion. He said, the works, the miracles that I have performed in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. The reason Jesus would walk on water, raise the dead, give sight to people who were blind, cure incurable diseases, leprosy, there was no cure for it. The reason Jesus did that, yes, it was for compassion for the individuals, to show his love, to show his power, but the reason Jesus would perform a miracle, the works I do in my Father's name, the reason Jesus performed a miracle so that when he suspended physical reality and did something that was impossible to do, walking on water, then people would hear him preach and they would say, oh, he's for real. Listen, nobody can walk on water. He is God's Son. Nobody can make an axe head float. He didn't do that. That's the Old Testament. God did it, but that miracle, it testifies to the power, authenticity of the person who did it. This man just cured 10 lepers. Didn't even touch them. They came back whole. He cured up. There's no cure for leprosy. Guess what? He is. And so when Jesus would perform a miracle, like he says, the works I do in my Father's name, it was to bear witness of him. It was to show the world I'm not just any other regular person. I'm not just Mr. Joe Blow. I'm not just Joseph's son, Mary's son. I'm God's only begotten Son. That's what Jesus said in verse 25. Now stay with me. We're going to get to chapter 11. Verse 26. He said, I've done all these things, but now I'm going to give you the contrast. You didn't believe me. You believe not. Because you are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. My sheep, verse 27, hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. Now what Jesus says in verse 26, we may not quite grasp it, but to a Jewish leader in the first century in the temple, when he says to them, you didn't believe because you're not my sheep, all these fighting words. It's like on the playground when somebody said, hey, you better not say nothing about my mom. I was thinking real now. When Jesus said, not only are you all not my shepherds, y'all are not even my sheep. Y'all don't even belong to me. I don't care about the robes you wear, the jewelry you wear, the respect you have, the prestige you have. I don't care how much money you're making. I don't care how many people come to you and ask you biblical questions about the Old Testament and people respect what you say. Not only are y'all not leaders for me, y'all are not even followers of me. And he said, let me tell you why. Because those that follow me, my sheep, hear my voice. And I know every last one of them, and guess what they do? They follow me. Not their own selfish desires. Not what the world says to do. Not what friends push you into doing. Not what family pushes you to do if it goes against what is right. The people that belong to me, they live like I want them to live. The people that belong to me, their life is not like everybody else's life. And he's saying to them, those people that follow me, this is what they look like. Y'all don't look like this. This is what Jesus is saying to them at church, in the temple, in their time. Now, if you jump down to verse number, now Jesus gives a bit more explanation. find until your body laid there lifeless. And when they heard Jesus say, you know I'm the vine, right? I'm not just a regular guy. They said, oh, we got to kill him. And as the chapter flows, he said, well, which one of my good works are y'all going to give me for? We're not killing you for good works. We are killing you because, verse 33, you're blasphemy. Because we don't believe what you just said. We don't believe that you are the Christ. We don't believe that you and the Father are one. And that goes back to what Jesus said in verse 25. I told you and you did not believe me. I showed you and you did not believe me. And he does it what? He shows grace. He tells them again, y'all ain't my sheep, but I am the good shepherd. Me and my Father are one. And what he said was true. They truly did not believe. So they picked up stones to kill him. As they were going to kill him, there's a conversation. Jump down to verse 39, John 10, verse 39. Therefore, they sought again to take him, that is to grab him by force and stone him, but he escaped out of their hand. And verse 40 tells where he went beyond the Jordan to Perea. And as we enter into John chapter 11, Jesus is in what's called the beyond. He's in a land called Perea. Back in Bethany, it's kind of like a movie. Jesus walks off, nobody touches him, the screen fades to black, and now you pick up in chapter 11, verse 1. There was a certain man that was sick. A man by the name of Lazarus, who lives, verse 1, it says, in Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And it said, now y'all remember Mary, verse 2? It was the Mary that anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair. It said, that Mary, her brother Lazarus was sick. So what did they do when their brother was sick? This wasn't the head cold. This wasn't sinus from some of the pollen in the air. No, no, this was some serious ICU, MRI, CAT scan. We don't know what's going on with him. He can't speak. His body's in pain. Whatever it was, it had risen to the level of this is serious. He's very sick. So when they had a crisis, verse 3 shows us how they responded. Therefore, his two sisters who loved him, sent unto him, that is unto Jesus, saying, Lord, behold, whom you lovest is sick. In other words, when their crisis came, they reached out to Jesus. Let me put a fence around this. I don't want us to get the wrong understanding. There's nothing wrong with going to the doctor. Amen, somebody. There's nothing wrong with taking your medication as it is prescribed. Amen, somebody. Yet, do these things, pray as well. Because when you pray, sometimes God can do stuff the medicine can't do. Sometimes God, I don't know how he does it, he can make the medication more potent, I guess the word. Sometimes God can minimize the time. The doctor said you're going to be out for a feet for a month. You back at work in 3 days. Listen, pray. Still, take it, doctor. Do what you should do. This is not saying don't do nothing but pray. No, no, no. So bad. Make sure that you incorporate what God can do as well as some practical means on top of this. But here they sent word to Jesus. The point behind it is whenever we have a crisis, the one person we need to call on. Nothing wrong talking to mama, friends, uncles, pastor, priest, whoever it may be. Somebody that is wise can give you some direction. But if you talk to all these folks and don't talk to Jesus, you really haven't done a complete thorough job, so to speak. So he wants us to lean on him the same way Martha and Mary did. Verse 4, when Jesus heard, here's what he said, verse 4, John 11, 4. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified by it. Verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha. Jesus said, I'm going to wait. Well, why? I'm going to wait the same way he said in John chapter 10, verse 25, the works I do in my Father's name, the miracles I perform, they bear witness of me. So what he's going to do is allow the natural events to play out. I'm going to get there and fix everything up. Everybody thinks the party's going to be over. There's nothing that can be done. And when I show them the darkest hour do not render me powerless, then I'm giving yet another example that I am who I said I am. That I and my Father are one. That I am, the lesson says, the resurrection and the life. So Jesus waited two more days. And one thing we learned about Jesus in the Bible, he never was in a hurry, but he never was late. Because whenever he gets there, it's the right time for him to be there. Because how many of us, and I'm going to raise my hand first, so I'll be first in line. How many of us get impatient? Oh, no. Ain't it like when you drive a lady, run a lady, you ought to get behind somebody that's slow. And it's like all three lanes, every car side by side. You know how you enter your car over trying to look? And so, you know, you're trying to, I don't want to break nobody, but, you know, because you're impatient. Man, I got to get to work, man. I hit snooze one too many times. They already talking crazy. That feeling of, move, hurry up. Let's get the ball rolling. Now, imagine them physically being with God in the flesh, Jesus. Knowing what he can do. Mary having anointed his feet with oil and wiped it with her hair. And Judas not talking crazy. Oh, the poor, you're going to have all this mess. Oh, let her alone. So she knew who he was, knowing that Jesus has what I need. Jesus can fix this situation. Can you imagine the impatience, knowing that help is available, but help ain't showing up? That the cure to whatever he's going through is available, but the person who can cure him is taking too long? That impatience could kind of set in. And Jesus said all these things are going to be done for the glory of God. And so then in verse number 7, after he says there's a small discourse with his disciples, he says, let us go into Judea again. Now when it says again, it's like saying, okay, you know they just tried to kill you in chapter 10. You know they just picked up stones and were about to stone you because you said, I and my Father are one, and you had to escape out of the hand. So if you go back there, Jesus, and they're already looking for you, and they're already mad at you, and the last time you were there, you almost lost your life, and if we can be honest, we almost lost ours as well. When they hear Jesus say, let us go back into the Judea again, I'm sure in their mind, there's a slight amount of apprehension. But look at verse number 8. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late, recently, they just tried to kill you there. And you said you want to go back there again? It's kind of like y'all seen these movies where folk go in the ocean and they're swimming, and they ask, oh, I swam all my life, and I'm surfing all my life, and one of them get their arm bit off by a shark. And then they out there, it wasn't a shark fault. You know, I was in his habitat. They out there in the water, and he's like, are you crazy? In my mind, I say, you couldn't keep, listen, I'll be hard-pressed to take a bath. talking about light versus darkness. He's talking about when you are alive versus when you are not alive. And what he's saying in verses 9 and 10, Jesus is giving them a quick Bible study. Serve and work with every opportunity that you have while it is light. Serve, participate, and work with every ounce of chance you have while you are alive. Because there will come a time to where you're no longer alive and those opportunities you have will not be there. And we can see a small portion of that to where when you're healthy versus when you're sick. When you're healthy, you can do things. When you're sick, you have a fever. You got a backache. You have whatever issues going on. When you're healthy, a healthy person who's alive and well and got all these opportunities to do for God, and then they reject him. Then when they're confined to a bed, sometimes regret them saying, I wish I could hear the choir saying again. I wish I could help hug after church and talk for an hour after church. I wish I had. Jesus ain't talking about health versus sickness. He's talking about life versus death. While you are alive, as the old preachers would say, while the blood is running warm in your veins, serve him. And Jesus is saying, listen, I'm going back for Lazarus. I'm taking this opportunity. In spite of the Jews, in spite of them wanting to kill me, I'm still in complete control, have y'all forgotten? And guess what? I'm not going to die until I decide to die anyway. I'm in control of all of these affairs. But he uses this as a lesson for his disciples. If you jump down to verse number 11, Jesus gets into the city. Jesus, there's a conversation with his disciples. He said, hey, Lazarus is not dead. He's sleeping. The disciples said, well, if he's sleeping, well, that means he's getting better. He's getting rest. Jesus responds very plainly in verse 14. Y'all not getting this. Lazarus is dead. He uses the phrase sleep for the death of a Christian. A temporary state is what sleep is. Nobody sleeps forever. Why? You go to bed at a certain time, wake up at a certain time. Guess what? You go to bed, the alarm goes off. Sometimes you can sleep so soundly, you're asleep with the alarm, but then just your natural body, when the sun comes up, wakes you up, you're like, oh man, it's time to get up. Jesus uses the analogy of sleep as he refers to the death of Christians, because for Christians, death is not the end for us. That's why he says it in this way. And we're going to look at that in the morning sermons. He said, Lazarus is sleeping, meaning a Christian has died. They said, well, if he's sleeping, then that's good. He clears it up in verse 14. Lazarus is dead, y'all. Look at verse 15. And I'm glad for your sakes, not that Lazarus is dead, not that tears are being shed, not that there's a grieving family, but I'm glad for my disciples, you 12, especially you Judas, you better pay attention. I'm glad for all of you all that I was not there to the intent that you may believe in me. He said, nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then we get to the first verse of our Sunday school lesson. Then when Jesus came, he shows up. Jesus gets there. He found that he had laid in the grave 4 days already. He shows up to the scene. It's been 4 days. Lazarus is no longer alive. The affairs of his life are over. As you hear people say, the books are closed on him. Lazarus, just like Jesus said, has been dead for 4 days. Verse 18. Now Bethany was close or nigh unto Jerusalem. It says about 15 furlongs off. Our Sunday school lesson tells us with that. That's about 2 miles. So Jerusalem was about 2 miles away. Verse 19, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. This lets us know, even according to our Sunday school lesson, they were a prominent family. But even more than prominent or prestigious, they were well loved. That people were concerned. story, I'm sure, began to circulate, you know, they were real close to Jesus. What the father of Jesus was in there? Then they sent word to Jesus. I heard they sent word to Jesus. Where did he? And he found out, why didn't he show up? I mean, what was he doing? I'm sure everybody's mind, just like our mind, would be having these natural thoughts. It's kind of like somebody, you know, so-and-so filed for bankruptcy, and they had the foreclosure on the house. Well, I thought their mama was president of the bank. I thought their dad was a vice president at Arcla or the entity or Cinnabon. I thought they were a wealthy, but I mean, when they had money, how did this happen? If this is true, how did this outcome happen? If Jesus loved them and they loved Jesus and they knew Jesus, Jesus spent the night at their house many times. So since they said, well, did they even tell them that left? They told them. Well, if they told them, well, why did these things happen? How did they happen? Not only were the surrounding people, as they comforted them, which was a good thing, probably had questions. We even said in our lesson, Mary and Martha had some questions too. As we go further with the lesson, look at verse 19. It says, the Jews came from Jerusalem to comfort them. Verse 20, then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went out and met him. But Mary, she still sat in the house. Now, there's a similar situation that Martha and Mary went through. When Jesus was at their home some time ago, Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to him teach. Martha was cleaning up and doing the practical cleaning and affairs of the house. And she looked around, as many people would. I'm in here washing dishes. I'm in here sweeping the floor. I'm getting all this grease off the stove, and the stove is black, and you know when you wipe this grease, you're leaving the streak. I'm trying to get this mess off the stove. I'll peek in the living room. She ain't there sitting down. Now, hold on now. This is inequitable. This is unfair. Jesus, can you tell her to get up off her duty and come help me clean this kitchen? Somebody got to take the trash out. The kids can put stuff in the microwave, then put a cover on it, and it's exploding. And I'm in here wiping everything, working. She's sitting down relaxing. Jesus said, well, hold on. You're reading this wrong. Because what she's doing is more needful. It's more important. It's more impactful. It may not help you clean your kitchen, but what she's learning from me will help her clean her life. So we can see even then, you see Mary, she's still sitting in the house. Martha, who's a bit more impulsive, she just heard that Jesus was coming close by. What does she do? That impatience. Running late for work, all three lanes covered, you inching around trying to see, can I get there? She said, I can't wait no more. I'm going to go out and meet Jesus myself. It says in verse number 18, Martha, as soon as she heard, verse 20, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary was still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, what could we have prevented, does it say in verse number 21? If you had been here, what wouldn't have happened? Huh?
Her brother wouldn't have died.
Now, I read the commentary of the lesson. It was saying this wasn't so much upset with Jesus. It was a statement of faith. And I guess, you know, six in one hand, half a dozen in the other, half full, half empty. Well, maybe she was saying, if you were here, you got so much power, I know you would have prevented this. But at the same time, the opposite side of the same coin, she's still the same, man, where was she? I mean, who wouldn't naturally, normally, instinctively have that question? And she said, Jesus, John chapter 11, in verse 21, if you hadn't been here, my brother would not have died. Now, even if her intent was to affirm his power, his deity, just in his humanness, as any one of us would, just in his humanness, sometimes you can see where she's saying, if you would have been here, you would have fixed it. But she also saying you weren't here at the same time. It's like you cook and everybody come over for Mother's Day and everybody sit down, want to have some good food, and now y'all sit down looking at the ID channel. You
you know, I shouldn't be alive, or whatever your favorite show is. You know, unbutton that top button. Oh, boy, you got your toothpick now. And then you look over to the person who holds it and say, you cook food good today. What do you mean today? On one hand, they're saying the food good today. On the other hand, they're saying, well, the other days it wasn't so good. It's kind of like you're getting both on one side. Jesus, if you would have been here, he'd be alive. On one hand, he's saying, well, yeah, you got power. You could have stopped it. On the other hand, you can't help but notice she's pointing out that you were not here. And so she said, if you would have been here, my brother would not have died. Look at verse 22. But I know, even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask God, he will give it to you. Jesus says unto her, your brother shall rise again. She responds and says, I know that he'll rise again. I even have good biblical theology to teach me that he will rise again in the resurrection in that last day. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. He'll rise again. I know that he'll rise again. They're having this theological conversation. She says, if you would have been here, he'd still be alive. Verse number 23, Jesus says, listen, your brother shall rise again. Verse 24, I know there's going to be a resurrection. Now she's correct. There will be a resurrection. We will see him again. So she has a complete understanding. I'm going to say she has an understanding of what happens after death. But it's an incomplete understanding about the whole thing. Because as she's speaking about the resurrection, some future event that she believes will happen, and she believes her brother, because he was a follower of Jesus and put his faith in God, he will be raised again during that resurrection. She believes that. But she's falling short when she forgets that Jesus is the one that's responsible for it all. Because he responds to her without a key verse, the I am statement that John gives. Jesus responds and says unto her, John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, even though physically his body is inactive, the blood is not flowing, the heart is not pumping, the brain has no reaction, the wave, the muscles and the nerves, they are all dormant. Though he were dead, do you know who you're talking to? Do you really know who I am? Yet shall he live. And then he says, if I can just help you with your understanding, verse 26, and whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Now, the critics of the Bible will say, now see, this is why the Bible is wrong. Because Lazarus is dead. Didn't it just say a few verses ago, he's been dead for 4 days, and now talking about never die? Well, I thought Lazarus believed in him, and the list of foolishness goes on and on and on and on. He's not talking about physical, temporal life. Temporal life is temporary. It will end. Jesus told his disciples in the previous chapter, see how it comes in, work while it's there. If you walk, a traveler walks in the daytime, he don't stumble because he can see. If a traveler walks or works in the nighttime, he stumbles because he can't see. When he's talking about daytime and nighttime, he ain't talking about sickness and health. He's talking about life and death. And guess what? There will be a time of light or life while you are alive. And guess what? While you're alive, serve him. Because guess what? You won't always be alive. So we do know physical life does come to an end. It does happen. Jesus is not referring to physical, temporal life. He said, what I offer, because I am the resurrection and the life, is eternal life. And let me tell you something. Who don't offer this? Muhammad don't offer this. Allah don't offer this. Joseph Smith don't offer this. The Pope don't offer this. Only offers this. Didn't he say in John chapter 10? I'm going to make sure I find it. In John chapter 10, as he's talking to them, when he says, verse 28, talking about his sheep, I give to my sheep eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Now we have a statement that Jesus makes, a truth claim. Now there's no wiggle room here. You either believe that or you don't. Listen, there's no symbolism, there's no funny talk, there's no parables. He either is telling the truth or he lying. Anybody ever watch court shows and Judge Judy and Judge Matthew's funny to me, but you know, I watch them and I hear cracking jokes. Everybody come on there, don't crack something. Doing something wrong. Y'all see the Judge Matthew. But you know, sometimes when you look at the court shows, what's the one the Ice T been on for 50 years? You know what I'm talking about. Lord, all oh, these shows. When a person gets on the stand, y'all, but you know what I'm talking about. When a person gets on the stand, lawyer is questioning them, and they catch him in a lie. I said, whoa, whoa, you said you got there at 10 o'clock. Now you're saying you got there at 2 o'clock? And then they just, well, they narrow the focus. They try to discredit that witness. And if you get caught as perjury, telling one lie on the stand, the lawyers, both teams, and the judge, they can strike everything you say off the record. You're not even fit to be a witness at all. You just lied. And if you lied about this, how we know you ain't lying about something else? So if Jesus just makes a truth claim as he's sitting on the stand being interrogated by the cynics and the critics or even people in the church, where he said, listen, if you follow me, you will never die. I give you eternal life. If he lied right here, the same way he's lying here, you've got to strike everything out. Which I'm going through this because I want you to know that's what eventually happens to people who consistently criticize the Bible, who consistently criticize what Jesus says, who don't have an understanding, and their heart becomes hardened, and they reject this, and they reject that, and they try to make amends for what they believe. Well, I think the Bible kind of 80% true and 20% false, and 10% God, 90% man. No. When it comes to Jesus, you either accept and embrace all of it, or the natural process that takes place is you reject all of it. And Jesus here just made a statement of fact. Verse 25, John 11, 25. I am the resurrection. I can raise you from the dead. And the life. He that believes in me, though his body has ceased being active, he's dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Now, Martha, I just gave you a sermon. Do you believe this? Now, that's the critical point right there. And that's where all of humanity sits. And your eternal destiny hinges on the fact or you not. There's no I'm like 50-50 pregnant. No. You either with child or you are not with a child. You either believe this or you don't. And belief is not a question mark, crossing your fingers, closing your eyes. I know. Faith, belief. Faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word of the Lord. There are many principles in Scripture that it's just hard to understand. And how does this coincide with this? They seem like they contradict. How do these things, well, you have to first back up. The author of Scripture is God. Is God honest or is God a deceiver? Is God love or is he not love? Is God smart enough to make everything come out right? He either is or he is not. There's no in between with that. So when you have some inconsistency, don't throw it in the towel. I'm doing the Bible. I'm doing the church. I can't understand it. Pray. Take time to check for yourself. know some trusted teachers. I know some trusted resources. Because there's a whole bunch of junk out there. And Lord knows, it's like trying to find clean drinking water in a sewer sometimes. Trying to find good, sound doctrine. And Lord, I bumped my head a thousand times. So I know some places where I know this is true. I've seen this is true. To hopefully, when somebody's at that crossroad, get that doubt question cleared up. And when you have a doubt, and then it gets cleared up, ironically, it strengthens your faith.
Rains and pours, and something else happens. 2 months later, the third thing happens.
He cried because it's like, I mean, yes, his heart went out to them, but it broke his heart that they don't think that I care enough or I'm powerful enough to do nothing about it. It's like you found out your child in college was selling his shoes and eating peanut butter and jelly and sold pictures off the wall and working odd jobs. It's like, you didn't call me dad. You didn't call mom. Well, I didn't want to bother you. There's still another one. Listen, mom and dad love you so much. If we got to make arrangements on light bill, we can get you some food. We can do something. We can call grandma. We can get your aunts. We can get your uncles. Like, you've been doing this all on your own. And the reason you did it all on your own is because you didn't think we could do nothing. Now, we may be limited. But when we do that to Jesus, who is unlimited, he has no limitations. Testify to yourself. Let your memory go down memory lane. Hasn't he done some things for you that you just didn't think you was going to be able to get? There was no way in the world this should have happened. This good thing, or you should have made it. Hasn't he done stuff for you to where you like? Amen. You brought me to Vietnam. You brought daddy through the Korean War. We used to have to travel at night versus the daytime, because certain parts of the city we couldn't ride during the daytime. You done brought us through water fountain, being separated, getting food through the back of the restaurant. Now we can own a bit. Lord, look at how far you brought me. Amen. And in those moments, and I've been there to where you just be like, and your grief, your sadness, your disheartening situation, yes, because of the current situation, but sometimes it spills over the top of the cup and it rolls onto the saucer of, you just don't think any other God can do this. That's why you're crying so much. That's why it hurts you that much more. It hurts you that much more because you know you can't do nothing, and on the other side of that is that you really don't think he can do nothing. And listen, this didn't anger Jesus. He didn't bring down fire on him. This didn't upset him and say, what's wrong with y'all? It's crazy. All this preaching and teaching I've been doing and praying, haven't y'all seen the works that I do? They bear witness of me. John chapter 10. He just told the disciples, I'm glad for y'all's sake I wasn't there. Why? So that when things come together, you'll be able to see that this was all for the glory of God. So Jesus steps forward, and the people see Jesus crying with her disciples. They said, look at how much he loved Lazarus. Now see, they even misunderstand his views. Of course he loved Lazarus. He loved Mary, Martha. He loved all of them. Truth be told, he loved Judas, and he knew Judas was going to betray him. So yes, it is factual. He did love Lazarus, but he wasn't crying primarily for that. His tears were not just for Lazarus. His tears were for the people who were still alive. They didn't think he was able to do anything with the situation. Verse 37. Now they begin to show the doubt outwardly. Some of them, thank God it wasn't all of them. Some of them said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should have not died? Same type of thought Mary and Martha probably could have had. Like, Lord, I heard in John chapter 9 there was a boy that was born blind, and your disciples walked by and said, who's seeing? His mother or his father, that he was born blind. Jesus said, this boy wasn't blind because somebody seen him. He's blind for the glory of God. He's spit in the ground, putting his eyes, told him to go wash his eyes. He opened up his eyes. He was born unable to see. And Jesus miraculously gave him his sight, and now they use that against him, saying, now you open people's eyes, but you didn't keep Lazarus alive. They use his good works against him.
was thinking and decaying. Jesus resurrected him and gave him life. Jesus is able to do that. He showed his power with our physical body. And guess what? When you are without Christ, the Bible describes that as being dead in trespasses and sin. There's some stuff you hooked on, involved in. If you wanted to stop, you couldn't. You don't have enough strength, enough might, enough dedication to nobody can take and change the heart of a man or a woman but the Lord. And sometimes, that's why I said, let your memory testify to you, whoever would have thought that the man or woman sitting here now that used to do X is actually here now. Whoever would have thought the person who did this and got involved in that and said this was a good thing and promoted it. No, that was wrong. Whoever would have thought God could have taken that person that was dead in trespasses and sin and changed them? Guess what? The same way he did it for physically for Lazarus, he can do it for your child, for your spouse, for you. He can do it for anyone who is willing. The key hinges at the end of verse 26 when he's talking to Martha and he tells her what he can do and who he is. The question is, do you believe this? Put your faith where God has put your thinking. That's on the cross of Jesus Christ. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, then you shall be saved. Now you're walking in the light and you don't stumble. Now you're in the Father's hand and don't let him pluck you out. Now he gives you eternal life and you shall never perish and never die. Guess what? This is a biblical theological truth, whether the world believes it or not. Amen. Shows his claim that he is the resurrection and the life. He lets us know that he's in charge of the affairs of everything that goes on. And even though it may look dark and difficult, he still has everything working according to his plan. Amen? So if you don't mind, let's stand and we'll go ahead and have us a closing prayer. They got muffins out there for mom. I believe we're going to be handing out tickets. And they might be giving a prize away at the end of church. Boy, they missed church today. Boy, they gonna be mad. They gonna be mad. Somebody get this crock pot. No, I ain't saying what it is. I got y'all in here. But let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Help us to lean and depend on your word, to walk according to it. Forgive us when we fail. Forgive us when we fail accidentally or intentionally. And thank you for being a patient God. We ask you this in the name of Jesus. Let every heart say amen.